Amazon shares in focus as it faces a probe in Europe over third-party selling. Kia stocks struggle as more corporate earnings roll in. The Philippine Central Bank should temper its policy rate cuts to keep the stock market attractive, says BPI Securities. And the enhanced anti-red tape law takes a big step towards full implementation. Hello, everybody. I'm Kathy Yang. You're watching Business Nightly. Futures point to a flat open as Wall Street sifts through the latest batch of quarterly corporate results. Bank of America beating estimates for quarterly profit as the U.S.'s second largest lender's loan book benefited from a healthy domestic economy. Consumer banking has held up for the big Wall Street banks that have reported second quarter results this week, cushioning a blow from weakness in trading and advisory businesses. But warning signs also emerged with J.P. Morgan, Citigroup and Wells Fargo reporting a dip in margins, stoking fears that interest rate cuts could further pressure profit by reducing the spread between what banks charge on loans and pay on deposits. Bank of America, however, bucked the trend and reported a 3 basis point increase in its interest margin to 2.44% for the second quarter. The lender is the most sensitive of the big U.S. banks to interest rate changes because of its large deposit stock and rate-sensitive mortgage securities. Stocks of the bank up 0.25% in pre-market trade. Investors also monitoring stocks of Amazon, now down 0.2% in pre-market trading, the e-commerce giant reaching a deal with Germany's antitrust authority to overhaul its terms of service for third-party merchants, acting to appease regulators. Within hours, however, the European Commission opened up a formal antitrust investigation to look into whether or not the company's use of independent retailers is in breach of EU competition rules. Taking a look at the markets just an hour and a half before trading, all of them up by about 0.1%. Over in Europe, stocks edged into positive territory, but then are all down as we speak, about 0.2%. The Eurozone inflation data showed improvement, but still fell short of the European Central Bank targets. Now back here at home, Philippine shares fell a second straight session, in step with most of its Asian markets. But as Michelle Long tells us, this may just be a healthy pullback traders are looking for to ensure a more sustainable rally.
Philippine shares wobbly all day, eventually ended down Wednesday, but still managed to stay in bull market territory. Papa Securities is calling it a healthy pullback.
So what we want to see is a gradual increase, not something that fast. So I would say that this pullback is actually healthy for the market. Usually when increases are simultaneous and high, they become unsustainable. So that's why I say this pullback is good for the market. So as long as we stay above the breakout level, preferably above 8.2, actually psychological resistance, we should be fine.
For the day, the PSE index lost 0.4% to close at 82.33, despite foreign funds continuing to net buy the local bourse. Volume was also a bit thin at just 5 billion pesos. BPI Securities, meanwhile, forecasting tempered earnings growth for the second quarter. So far, just one index issue has released earnings. SM Prime, which came in line with expectations, posting a 16% increase in profit for the quarter and for the first half of the year.
I think the second quarter growth on a year-on-year basis should be pretty similar to the last quarter, about 7%. I think you would see an acceleration more towards the fourth quarter of 2019. That said, I don't think this market will need to show 10 or 11% growth for it to kind of maintain these levels. But on the other hand, I don't think earnings are really going to move the needle again.
In corporate story, Cebulan Masters is in talks with Xavier University Ateneo de Cagayan for the proposed development of a new township project in northern Mindanao, a university town to be built on a 63.5-hectare Manresa property. The plan? To build modern buildings, dormitories, interconnected courtyards, a museum, gallery and theater, with a space big enough to accommodate up to 25,000 students. Cebulan Masters plans to buy a 14.3-hectare portion of the property to integrate commercial, residential, office, and leisure facilities. This is the company's second estate project after its Davao Global Township, phase one of which is scheduled to be completed by 2023. The company has earmarked 13 billion pesos for capex this year. It has also just recently launched 1.3 billion pesos worth of residential projects in northern Mindanao. Now here's an interesting development in what some people are calling succession planning of the Lushatan Group. The tycoon, who's actually turning 85 today, has just been appointed transition president of Philippine Airlines. And that's on top of his capacity as PAL chairman. This follows the retirement of its longtime head, Jimmy Bautista. His daughter, Vivian Tan, who is currently executive vice president, treasurer, and chief administrative officer of PAL, said this is pending approval by the board for candidates for the top post. She adds she will assist her father in the day-to-day operations.
This is a sign of some succession planning, but when it comes to the Lushatan-controlled companies, we're actually especially interested in PNB. There has been a lot of rather volatile movement there lately, and I think this is because of talks of a foreign partner coming in, which has historically been what the Lushatan strategy is.
PAL shares were flat at 9.35 apiece. Michelle Long, ABS-CBN News.
The Philippine Central Bank should temper its policy rate cuts to keep the Philippine stock market attractive. That's according to BPI economist Jun Neri, who says the market is pricing in a full dialing back from the current 4.5% to 3%, where it was late 2017. Neri adds the Philippine government should mind its rate differential against that of the U.S. Fed. Here's an excerpt of my exclusive chat.
At these levels, it seems that the market is pricing in a full dialing back of the Banco Central's policy rate from the current 4.5% to 3%, where it was at around the latter part of 2017. No? And that to us, while it's good for the market, it's good for the government, it's cheap to borrow, it looks a little bit ahead of itself. No? The market appears to have been a little bit ahead of itself. It's very possible that it could pull back because our understanding is the central bank, yes, they will continue to cut interest rates. They will reduce the triple R some more, but probably not to the extent that the market seems to be pricing in at the moment.
Which is 3%. So what are you forecasting? What are you tipping for if you just put your central banker hat?
Well, we think they can do one or two more cuts before the end of the year to bring down the policy rate from 4.5 to 4, maybe 4.25. No? But to bring it all the way down to 3 looks very implausible at this point. No? Because even if we do, we are one of the more optimistic research teams in the market looking at below 2% inflation in the third quarter, Kathy. So that means that the BSP really has a lot of room from now until the end of the year to reduce rates. But to be able to bring that all the way down to 3%, we think it's a little bit too fantastic. And since that is what the market pricing in today, it looks a little bit too much.
If we dial forward and keep that advice, just mind the gap. Should it be the case on the way down if the Fed cuts, the Philippine Central Bank should keep that interest rate differential as wide as possible, as you can see on the graph there? Why do have they mind the gap? What is important?
The narrowing of the gap could lead to rapid outflows of foreign funds, Kathy, as they won't find the Philippine assets yielding attractive enough yields. Now, that happened, I think, in the early part of last year when the differential fell down to 1.25 percentage points. No? So to avoid that same situation, we think that the central bank must limit its rate reductions to a level that will prevent an approach back to that 125 basis point differential.
After over a year, the Philippines' enhanced anti-red tape law takes a big step towards full implementation as key officials sign the measures implementing rules and regulations. Bruce Rodriguez tells us the salient points of the rules and how it aims to improve the ease of doing business in the country.
It's been over 10 years in the making. Officials from the Trade and Civil Service agencies joined the newly appointed Director General of the Anti-Red Tape Authority in signing the implementing rules and regulations of the Ease of Doing Business and Efficient Government Service Delivery Act of 2018. ARTA Director General Jeremiah Belhica, who was just appointed to the helm last week, says he plans to hit the ground running and have the IRR published just a day after its signing so that it can take effect 15 days after. And once it does take effect, Belhica says the public can finally take government officials or agencies to task if they can't deliver transactions within the prescribed 3, 7, or 20 days. This would cover all government agencies from national departments to local government units, while exempting constitutional bodies, which are the Commission on Elections, Audit, and Civil Service. He adds they can also start accepting initial complaints.
What do you mean by initial complaints? Initial complaints are complaints that could take in any form. Text, call, Facebook Messenger, and also electronic means to receive complaints. So it doesn't need to be formalized yet.
Belhica also explains these complaints should contain the name of the complainants, their contact number, the agency they're complaining about, the violation committed, and evidence of the act. The British Chamber of Commerce of the Philippines welcomes the signing of the rules. BCCP Chairman Chris Nelson says this would further encourage investors to set up shop in the country, adding it would also boost foreign direct investments. But he points out it will still boil down to the measure's implementation.
We've been a keen supporter of the ease of doing business. We've also been obviously pushing to have it fully implemented. Obviously, with the appointment of the Director General and the promise that they're going to fully implement it, we see this as a great signal to investors.
Former National Competitiveness Council co-chair Bill Luz agrees, saying a clear indicator of the law's success would be an improvement in the country's ranking in global competitiveness surveys.
And as they get more efficient, I think the impact on the economy will be that as it becomes easier to file for a business permit, for instance, we should expect more businesses to be filed and more job generation. We've seen it in cities which improve their mayor's permit applications. They typically have more businesses there and more jobs generated than in a city where it is still very slow.
The Philippines has been struggling to improve its ranking in ease of doing business surveys, blamed on weaknesses in government efficiency, business efficiency, and infrastructure. Bruce Rodriguez, ABS-CBN News.
Think Tank Economist Intelligence Unit urges the Philippine government to address structural weaknesses to sustain economic growth. EIU analyst Anwita Basso explains, while Philippine shares are in a bull market and the peso is at its strongest in nearly 18 months, other elements of growth are missing. Basso notes the Philippines has not been advancing as fast as other economies like Vietnam, resulting in a drop in the country's rating in various global rankings.
Other elements of the economy, however, hasn't fared as well. Of course, we've seen a growth slowdown this year so far compared to last year. We haven't seen much uptick in employment growth, and generally investment, FDI, has not picked up. Could be structural weaknesses. I think last year's inflation overheating was a testament to that. It wasn't because oil prices flared up. It was because there were issues around logistics.
Basso expects a pickup in GDP from the first quarter's 5.6%, citing a recovery in government spending after an impasse over this year's national budget was resolved. Up next, more rains expected despite Tropical Storm Falcon about to leave the Philippine area of responsibility. The latest weather update when Business Nightly returns.